Bless the Lord, everyone, and welcome to another of our Bible studies. Today we'll continue looking at the topic, the mind of Christ. Just before we get into our discussion, let us just pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your goodness and your mercies. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to look at your words. We thank you, O God, for the light that you have shine on your words. Jesus, we pray that your presence will be here, that it will lead and it will guide us into your truth. Have your own way, O God, as we give you all the glory. You alone is worthy of all the praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So, in our last session, we look at the genesis of the word Christian. And we said that, you know, the Christians were first called, the disciples rather, were first called Christians while they were in Antioch. We also look at the implication as in terms of how Jesus uses the term, follow me. And he used it quite extensively throughout his ministry. We have shown where you'd have called the majority of his disciples that was actually recorded, how he had called them, you know, some way or form. This phrase was used in it. And we also made a point that as Christian we are to have a vision that guide our daily life. And we were suggesting that being like Christ should be that vision. We also looked at in terms of, you know, how do we become like Christ? You know, we said that knowledge of Christ was essential for this. And so we look at the scripture that says that when he shall appear, when the Lord shall appear, we are going to be like him, the writer said. And the reason the writer gave for us being like Christ is because we are going to be able to see him as he is. And so having a knowledge of Christ is truly essential in our walk with Christ and in our endeavor to be more like him. We can only be more like him when we know more and more about him. And many scriptures in the Bible support that. And so, as we start this class, we're going to first just look at the Gospels. We're going to look at a couple of the books of the Gospel. These, as we had said before, are rich source. These are rich source of the knowledge of Christ. These are rich source of the knowledge of Christ. And it is important for us to just have some form of a guide as we read and interpret these books. So let us start with today's lesson. So as I said before, we are looking at doing an overview of the gospel books. The first three books are called Synoptic Gospels, that is Matthew, Mark, Luke. And the reason they are called Synoptic Gospels is because these books, they basically write about the same event, the same miracles that Jesus did. You would find them repeating in each of these books. We say that they gave parallel accounts. And for example, three-quarters of the book of Matthew is actually a duplication of the book of Mark. So if you would have read the book of Matthew, you would have probably gone through three-quarters of the material that is actually in the book of Mark. 11-12, that's almost the entire amount. 11-12 of Mark is actually reproduced in Matthew. You know, 11-12 of Mark is reproduced in Matthew. And we said three quarter of Mark, you can also found in Luke. So three quarter of the event, the miracles, the parables that you would have read in Mark, they are duplicated in Luke. However, there are some scriptures that we can only find or can only be found in Mark. And let us actually turn to a couple of these. So these scriptures, you won't find them in any other of the Gospels. So let us turn to the scripture, Mark 4, verse 26. So this is a scripture that is only found in Mark. You won't find this in Matthew and in any other of the gospel. And he said, so is the kingdom of God, as if a man should cast seed into the ground. You know, and so it is a parable about the man that cast seed in the ground. The Bible said that, and he would sleep and rise night and day, and the seed should sprung and grow up, he knoweth not how. So this is a parable. As I say, it goes up to about 28. So this is a scripture that we said that you can only find this scripture in the book of Mark. You won't find it in Luke, John, or any of the other gospel. You know, this is found in Mark only. Okay, next slide. Okay, and this is another one that we can only be found in Mark, and it's Mark 14, verse 51. And it says, and there followed him a certain young man, having a linen cloth cast about his naked body, and the young man laid hold on him, verse 52, and he left the linen cloth and fled from them naked. So this is the writer giving an account of what had transpired when Jesus, just before Jesus, you know, would have been crucified. And as I said, this account can only be found in the book of Mark. So there are actually 88 incidents in the Bible. Now, when we say incidents, we're talking about things that Jesus would have done, whether it be miracles that he would have performed, whether it be a parable, whether it be anything that any major thing that he would have done. We said that we call those incidences. And so we said that there were actually 88 incidences that are recorded throughout the gospel. And we can find 71 out of these. 71 out of the 88 can actually be found in the synoptic gospels. So as I said before, these are called synoptic gospels because the general plan and the order of the events, they are basically similar. So we call that them the synoptic gospel. Next slide, please. However, there are some difference even with the synoptic gospels. We have a few differences, right? So we are saying that there are 17 incidences that are included in only one or two of the gospel. So there are 17 things that happen that you can only find them in only one or two. So they are not in all three of the gospels. There are a few verbal differences also in parallel accounts. Anyone know of any of these differences? For example, If you look at Matthew 28, verse 19, it gives an account of the great commission of Christ. Luke 24 and verse 44 and 45 also gave that account. But, you know, in terms of how it is verbally worded, it's a bit, you know, there's a slight difference in terms of how it is verbally worded, but the content is the same. And of course, we are saying that the fourth gospel, and that is the gospel of John, is actually called apologetic. And it's not primarily biographical. So John Gospel is not in, you know, it's not included. It's not accounted as a synoptic gospel. We say that it's apologetic, and it is generally different in its ordering and the information that is there. Continue. So we ask ourselves, why four gospels? Why do we have four Gospels? Well, one of the reasons we had three great nations around during Jesus' time. So we had the Romans, we had the Greeks, and we had the Jews. So there were three great nations around in Jesus' time. And each one of these Gospels were actually written primarily to one of these great nation that was around. And so they show that Jesus is the answer for these groups, you know, because each of these groups, the Romans would have think they have the answer. The Greek also, great philosophical nation, they would have believed they know what and they have the answer. And the Jews also believe, you know, they knew what is what and what is the answer. But the writer is saying to them that, look here, you know, we know what you think, but Jesus is the answer. Whether you are Roman, whether you are Greek, or whether you are Jews, Jesus is the answer. So Mark primarily wrote to a Roman audience. And you will see in the book of Mark, it is probably it is the shortest of all the books, and it is tailored, as it were, to best present Jesus to the Romans. The Romans were a pragmatic nation, set of people. You know, they were kind of a macho. They were not so much into a lot of teaching, you know, but they wanted action. They were result oriented, and so you find that Matthew, his style was suited for this. Mark's styles were suited for this. If you notice how he presents Christ, you know, he's always presenting Christ on the go, straightforward. Jesus did this, you know. It was ideal. It was an ideal witness to the Romans nation. Matthew, on the other hand, he wrote to the Jew, and the thing about the Jew is that they are looking for a Messiah. They are looking for a Messiah to come and fulfill all the Testament prophecies. And so Matthew wrote, you will see that he presented Jesus as the fulfillment of these Old Testament prophecies. And so when you read the book of Matthew, you will hear him say that, so that this can be fulfilled, you know, what was said of the prophet, or so that this can be fulfilled. So Matthew presented Jesus as, you know, the fulfillment of the Old Testament prophecy. They were looking for a Messiah to come, and they knew all the Old Testament prophecies, and Matthew wrote about Christ to show that he fulfilled all that was recorded in the scripture, you know, about him. Luke wrote primarily to the Greek, And the Greek desired an ideal man. And so, you know, Luke presented Jesus in such a way. John, on the other hand, his account had a universal appeal. And John, he specifically speak about the deity of Jesus. And so if we look at these, just in terms of the genealogy that each of these writers would present. Now, Mark didn't have a genealogy at all. Because, as I said, the Romans is not into a lot of the teaching and a lot of those. You know, they wanted action. And so Mark presented a lot of the action that Jesus did and not so much a lot of teaching around him. There wasn't a lot of parable. If you read the book of Mark, you'll find that there wasn't a lot of parable there, you know. And as I said before, this is one of the reasons he didn't have a genealogy. Matthew had a genealogy, you know, and Luke also had a genealogy. I believe, and I'm going from memory here, if you look at the genealogy of Matthew, I think he actually stopped it at Abraham, if memory serves me right. And this is in agreement with the fact that he was writing to the Jews, and Father Abraham is a central figure where the Jews are concerned. I believe, again going by memory, that Luke actually traced the genealogy back to Adam, which was show you that, you know, he was writing generally and not so much focusing on the Jews as Matthew did. Now, the interesting thing is John and the so-called genealogy of John, because John's genealogy actually goes beyond the start of the earth. And you will recall John 1 verse 1 says, in the beginning was the Word. You know, so John's genealogy even looked at God before the creation of the earth. And as I said, he presented more the deity of Jesus. And in keeping with that, you know, the genealogy that he used was in support of the view that he was taking. Next step. So let us now look a little bit more on the book of the Gospel of Mark. So we said that Mark is the oldest of the four Gospels. So this was the first Gospel that was written. It was written around AD 65. Mark closely represents the order in the incident of the life of Jesus Christ. So it's Mark wrote exactly as it would have occurred. That's what is believed. So we said that he wrote to impress the pragmatic Romans, and so, you know, he would have tailored a lot of the things that he was saying in a way or in a shape so that the Romans would be impressed by these things. One of the characteristics of the book of Mark is that you'll find that he explained Jewish culture and any Jewish terminologies that is used. All right, so let us look at a few of these explanations that Mark would have included in his book, you know, so having, you know, knowledge that the audience that he is writing to would not necessarily know some of these terminology. So he took the time out to explain them. Let us look at Mark. We're going to look at Mark 3 and verse 17, Mark 5 and verse 41. And we can just look at those two. We have to look at all of them. And Jesus, the son of Zebedee, and John, the brother of James, and he surnamed them Boanerges, which is the son of thunder. So here you find he is explaining the terminology here. You know, the son, he surnamed them Boanerges, which is the sons of thunder. So he's explaining that terminology there to them, because, you know, a Jewish person would probably know what that mean, but a Roman probably wouldn't. And so he took the time out to explain that to them. Let us look at the other scripture. And he took the damsel by the hand and said unto her, Talitha come, which is being interpreted, damsel, I say unto thee, arise. So again, he is explaining the terminology that was used there because of the audience that he was writing to. Continue. Next slide. Okay. And as I said, there are others, but we won't go through all of them. Now, the book of Mark, some scholars believe, or some scholars call the book of Mark, Peter's gospel. If you actually read the book of Mark, you would see that certain insight that is written there. You know, Peter would probably be one of the disciples that would be there. It is believed that Mark and Peter was good friends, and Mark actually wrote Peter's account of the gospel. All right, let us continue. So this is a outline of the book of Mark. Start off by doing the arrival of an identity of the servant. So again, Mark present Jesus here as the servant, or as the ideal servant. As I said before, there is no genealogy. From Mark 1, verse 12 to 13 speaks about the fidelity of the servant. In Mark 1, verse 13, you know, we get the account of the temptation of Christ. And from Mark 1 to chapter 13, Mark 1, 14 to Mark 13. Sorry, let me say that again. From Mark 1, verse 14, to chapter 13, verse 37, it covers the servant at work. So this is where you'll find most of the ministry of Jesus as it's recorded in the book of Mark found. It speaks about the servant obedient to death, and that is found in Mark 14 from verse 1 to 15. And then, of course, it speaks about the rise and the glorification of Jesus, and that can be found in Mark 16 verse 1 to 20. So let's say Mark is a very short book, and one of the reasons why it is so short is because of who it was written to. All right, let us look at Matthew. Now, who did we say Matthew was written to again? The book of Matthew was written to the Jews. So this book at one point was called the one of the most important book of Christendom. Right? The only record contribute by Matthew. Now, when you look at Matthew, when you look at the gospel, I think Matthew's name is mentioned once, maybe twice, but I think once, and it was actually his call. You know, when Jesus went to call him from his job, and you know, he said to him, he went to Matthew and said, follow me. And that is all that is recorded about Matthew in the Gospels. And then when you look at after the Gospel, you don't see anything about Matthew anywhere. You don't find Matthew, I don't think he was ever mentioned in the book of Acts or any of the Gospel. So the book of Matthew is Matthew's only contribution in terms of the records. I'm sure you'd have done lots of work, you know, as an apostle, as a disciple. But most of what Matthew did, you don't have any record of it. You know, this book that he wrote is probably the only thing we know about him. So we said that the gospel was written primarily to the Jews. He sought to prove that Jesus was the Messiah foretold in scriptures. Right, so that is what Matthew wrote about. He wanted to convince the Jews that Jesus was the Messiah that was foretold in the scriptures. Matthew 1 verse 1 and Matthew 27 verse 37 are the key verse in this book. And let us look at these two scriptures. And so here again, as I was saying, that this is actually the beginning of the genealogy of Jesus. And he started off by saying, the book of the generation of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. So right there, he started with Abraham, because everybody knows that to the Jews, you know, Father Abraham is a central figure. And so he started the genealogy of Jesus there. Next scripture. And so this is Matthew 27 verse 37. And he set up over this, over his head, this accusation written, this is Jesus, King of the Jews. So this is actually, as I said before, you know, why Matthew wrote. He wanted to prove, you know, that Jesus was actually the King of the Jews. To the slide. So we said that these are the key verses in the book. The words and phrases are in keeping with Matthew's desire to portray Jesus as the king, the royal seed for whom Israel waited. So, you know, he presented Jesus in this light. Matthew also presented Jesus as the teacher and emphasized his prophetic and miraculous power. So he emphasized his prophetic and his miraculous power, because he believed that by doing this, you know, this is the way you would be able to convince the Jews that he was actually the Messiah. It has been suggested that the immediate purpose of this gospel was to save the faith of Jewish Christians. So there was a big calamity that would have happened, and it is believed that, you know, Matthew was written to kind of stabilize and to save the faith of Jewish Christians. Next slide, please. As I said, I just wanted to give you a bit of an overview of these books, so that as you read them, you are able to bear in mind why they were written, and then you can understand, you know, why certain terminologies were used. You know, for example, when we look at the book of Matthew, you know, Jesus would have said in Matthew 28 verse 19, go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Now, Matthew knew that the audience that he was writing to would understand what he means. And so he could write like that. You know, somebody said, why didn't he just say Jesus? Because that's what he means. You know, but to him, it was as if he was just saying that because he knew that they knew, you know, what is meant by the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. And so, as I said, the terminology here is fitted to the audience. All right, this is the outline of the book of Matthew. We talk about the king's birth. We talk about the forerunner. We know that the forerunner was John the Baptist. We spoke about the test or his temptation. That is found in Matthew 4, verse 1 to 11. The proclamation, that is Matthew 4. The king's law, you can find that in Matthew 5. So this is, as I said, this is an outline of the book of Matthew. His ministry, you can find that from Matthew 8 to Matthew 11. In Matthew 11, verse 20 to 34, that is where he was rejected by the Jews, as it was. The triumphant entry, you can find that in Matthew 21, verse 1 to 5. His death and resurrection, you can find that from Matthew 26, 1 down. So this is, as I said, a basic outline of the book of Matthew, you know. So when you're reading this, when you're reading the book of Matthew, you can bear these in mind. So the gospel according to Luke. So Luke's gospel was called one of the most beautiful books that was ever written. You know that Luke was the beloved physician. He was a traveling partner with Paul. Luke is the book of Luke is the universal gospel. It describing Jesus as the savior of all men, the seeker of the lost among all people. So again, we said that Luke is a universal gospel. It described Jesus as the savior of all men, not just the Jews, but all men. The seeker, he described Jesus as the seeker of the lost among all people. In Luke, Jesus declared his mission was to preach the gospel to the poor. You can find that in Luke 4, verse 18. Jesus' association with the publican and sinners, this is evidence in the book of Luke, where, you know, he's described as being a friend of the publican and a friend of the sinner. Jesus spoke about the lost coin. So again, you know, showing that Luke is a universal book that was geared towards, you know, seeking and saving those that was lost. Not just the Jews now, but lost humanity. And so when you look at the book of Luke, a big part of that is the parable about the lost coin, the lost sheep, and the lost son, or as we call it, the prodigal son. This gospel set forth most clearly Jesus' way of life. So if you even read the beginning of the book, you will find that Luke, you know, wrote that he wanted to set in order the things that would, you know, believe. So it distinctly points out the characteristics of Christian life. And this is another great part of the book of Luke. It actually speaks to Christian living, such as self-denial and prayer. It is believed that in this book, there is more mention or more reference to prayer than in any of the other gospel. Next slide. So, as I said before, it has more reference to prayer than any of the other gospel. There's a great emphasis placed on discipleship. So, when you read the book of Luke, there's a great emphasis. Jesus placed a lot of emphasis on discipleship. It's also a gospel for the young. Luke is a gospel for the young, more reference about young men than any other gospel. So you'll find a lot of reference here being made about young men than any other gospel. Also, in the book of Luke, the writer took time out to speak more about the childhood of Jesus, you know, more than any other gospel. But Luke is also called the gospel of women. And you'll find that there is a great emphasis placed on, and there are some women that would have had central, you know, would be, there's great emphasis placed on them. So like Mary and Martha and several other women. When you read the book of Luke, you'll find a lot of emphasis placed on women that was around, you know, while Jesus lived. So for these reasons, it is also called the gospel of women. The only book that explicitly presents the gospel as the good news of God's love. So that's another thing about Luke. You know, it explicitly presents the gospel as the good news of God's love. There are three parables of restoration. We spoke about these already. The lost son, the lost coin, and the lost sheep, or the prodigal son, rather. Continue. So in Luke, we see the love of, you know, the writer emphasized the love of God. Jesus taught So he presents God as anticipating the need of his children. You know, he's concerned about the small details of our life. You can find that in Luke 12, verse 7. That God will respond quickly to our cry for help. And that is found in Luke 11, verse 9 to 13. And that is that even to the unthankful and merciful to sinners. So God is loving even to the unthankful and also to the merciful. And you can find that in Luke 6, verse 35. While Luke spoke of the deity of Christ, all the writers would have included a little about the deity of Christ, but Luke emphasized primarily his humanity. You know, he presented Jesus as being the ideal man. The key verse in Luke is Luke 23, verse 47. We can turn to that. Now, when the centurion saw what was done, he glorified God, saying, certainly, this was a righteous man. This is making reference to Jesus, you know. And this, scholars say, is the key verse in the book of Luke. Continue. Next slide. So this is the outline of the book of Luke. It presents that he was made like unto his brethren. It speaks about his temptation that can be found in Luke 4 verse 1. Hebrew 4 verse 15 says that he was tempted in like points as we were, yet without sin. He is presented as the man that is touched with the feeling of our infirmities. The man as our kinsman redeemer. You can find that in Luke 19, verse 28 to 23. The man still as a man in resurrection. So he was a man even in his resurrection. It is like of a first fruit of them that sleep. And so Jesus here is presented and kind of give the first look at what we will be after we die and is resurrected. Next slide. So John's gospel is a little different. So we said that it wasn't among the synoptic gospel. It gives Jesus revelation of himself to the world and more intimately to his disciple. His gospel was designed to combat certain errors that were then prevailing concerning the deity of Christ. And this is important because it gives it a purpose why John was written, the book of John, and it was written specifically to address certain concerns or certain errors that was floating around the place concerning Jesus' deity. And so if you want to learn about the Godhead and you want to use the book, the gospel books, then John is definitely the book that you look at. In this gospel, John presented Jesus Christ as the one who we are to believe. That is the theme. In contrast to the other books, John has only 8 of the Lord's miracles. So not a lot of the Lord's miracles is mentioned, recorded in the book of John. All of which shows the power of the Lord's word and of his word alone. Right? So John portrays Jesus as God manifested in the flesh. Alright, next slide. John portrayed Jesus as God manifested in the flesh, becoming the Son of God in redemption. Jesus revealed as Son of God, the mighty God, by his deeds and by his words. So in the book of John, Jesus is revealed, we're saying, as the Son of God. He is the mighty God, and this is done through his deeds and through his words. Jesus, the Son of God, the mighty God, revealed himself more fully to his own. And you can find that in John 13, verse 1 to 17. Jesus, the Son of God, slain. You can find that in John 18, verse 19. Jesus is claimed to deity, fully established by his resurrection. You can find that in John 20, verse 21. Next slide. Jesus is God. Those are the 4 books of the gospel. So those are the 4 books of the gospels, right? And we find that, as I said, you know, wanted to touch on them because I believe it will give us a little bit more insight as we read these gospel books. Most of what is written here you can find in any good commentary about the gospel. So it's not any great it's knowledge that is out there, and you can find, as I said, in most commentary and any good commentary that you read, you'll be able to find the information that was on those slides before, right? But what is interesting to me about this is that, you know, each one of them presented Jesus in a different light. And they presented him in a different light, not so much based on, you know, who they were. It's not based on who the writers were, but it was based on the audiences. And that is something that I believe that, you know, that I could do more of. You know, the question is, how do I present Christ? You know, it's not just good enough to say, well, we're just going to give them Acts 2:38. And that is it. You know, but we find that these writers, they did some form of a research, as it were, on their audience and the person that they were writing to. And they catered the gospel message in a way that would cause these people, you know, to most likely receive it. You know, they presented Christ in a way that is more pleasable, you know, are more acceptable to them. And I mean, all of us do this in some shape or form. Most of us probably would not teach a kindergarten class the same way we teach a bunch of adults. You know, we wouldn't do it, we wouldn't do that. But most of us is, you know, that's where we draw the line, where age is concerned. You know, but these writers show us that it's not only age that we can consider, you know, to when we are looking at how to present Christ, but we can look at other things. We can look at their characteristics. You know, we can also look at their career. You know, do we present Jesus to the farmer the same way we present him to the physician? You know, do we present him to the lawyer the same way we present him to a medical student? Maybe not. You know, maybe there is a way for us to highlight certain aspect of Christ that is more geared towards them a lawyer getting saved, a farmer getting saved, you know, as opposed to just a blanket, I'm going to just preach Christ and that's it. So that's one thing that jumps out at me from how this gospel writer presented Jesus. Another thing that jump out to me is that, you know, no man is an island, and it is when we take every person's view into consideration that we will have the full knowledge of Christ. Paul said it, you know, that each person bring a psalms, bring an exhortation. Here we're seeing that John would have written about Jesus in a certain light. And when you read it, when you read the book of John, you understand Jesus based upon how John presented him. When you read Matthew, you understand the same Jesus, but in a slightly different light, how Matthew presented him. And the same thing with Luke and Mark. And then when you put it all together, we get a more fulsome appreciation of who Jesus is. And that is something that I believe that we should take note of and, you know, and operate accordingly. All right, so those are the books, the gospel books. Now we're going to just move into, you know, who was Jesus, certain of the characteristics or the nature of Jesus. Let us look at 1 John 1, verse 1. So we're going to look at 1 John 1, verse 1, and we're going to also look at 1 John 1, verse 14. Timothy 3, verse 16 also. So John starts off again by saying that which was from the beginning, which we have seen, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled, right, of the word of life. All right, so this is 1 John 1 verse 1. We're going to come back to that, but we're going to also look at St. John 1 verse 1. So it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Now verse 14. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. All right, you can go back to the slide. Let us go back to the slide. So when we look at Timothy 3 verse 16, right? It says that without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness, right? God was manifested in the flesh, justified in the spirit, you know, seen of angels, and so forth. We know the scripture well. In John 1, John wrote and said, in the beginning was the Word. Now, the term, the Greek word logos here is translated word. And logos, as said before, is a Greek term. And what the Jews, how the Greek thinks, how the Greek thinks, the Greek said that before you have a thing, or before something can exist, you know, you have to have a thought. So before I can have a vehicle, before I can have a motor car, I have to have a plan for that motor car, like a design. You know, before you have a house, you have a plan for the house. So that is how the Greek thinks. But it is believed that the Hebrew actually went a bit further in their reasoning. And the Hebrew says that, okay, yes, that is right. I agree. Before you have a thing, you know, you must have a plan for the thing. But before there is a plan for the thing, you must have a thinker. You must have somebody that that think up the thought. You know, thought just come up by themselves. And so here it is believed that John was, you know, he was writing, he was using the Hebrew, the Greek terminology, but his thought was more Hebrew. So he was saying that, you know, in the beginning was the word or the thought, but he was also saying that, you know, the thought was with the thinker. And so that's how we get, in the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, even as how my thought is with me. He went on to say that, you know, the word became flesh. And so that marks the incarnation of Jesus Christ. When the word, or, you know, God became flesh. The scripture speaks about we beheld in the glory, his glory, even the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. All right, next. All right, so Colossians 2 verse 9 tells us that Jesus, for in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. So he's saying that everything that made God, God, everything that made God, God, could be found in Christ, and it could be found in him in a bodily form, you know. So the fullness of the Godhead, notice the writer is saying that the fullness of the Godhead dwell in Jesus, not that Jesus dwell in the fullness of the Godhead, right? There's a distinct difference, because some person will tell you that, you know, Jesus is the second person in the Godhead, you know, but that's not the terminology that the Bible used. The Bible didn't say, you know, that Jesus was in the Godhead. The Bible says that Jesus, that the Godhead was in Jesus. And I also want you to notice that this is an emphatic statement, because he is saying that all, and all, as I like to say, all means all. So when he say all the fullness, he's saying that everything that made God, God, could be found in Jesus. But what does fullness mean? Fullness also means all. Everything, you know, so he's using these two terminologies to emphasize that the Godhead, or the deity of God. When we speak about the Godhead, we are speaking about the deity of Christ, right? All of that could be found in Jesus Christ. I actually put on the slide the amplified version of the same scripture. And it says, for in him, or in Jesus, all the fullness of the deity, that's how the amplified version translates it, and then he put in bracket, Godhead dwells in bodily form, in Jesus Christ. So Jesus was, you know, was God in the flesh. He was God incarnate. You know, the Bible said to wit or to know that God was in Christ. He was doing what? He was reconciling the world unto himself. All right, so God was in Christ, as we said. He is reconciling the world unto himself. So 1 Timothy 2 verse 5 says, for there is one God, and there is one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. So not only was Jesus, as I said, fully God, right? And when we say that Jesus is God, we are saying that we know some things. Right? Now, let us back up a bit. Because the Bible says, great is the mystery of godliness. Now, the thing of... So we know it's a mystery. And we know that there are some things that we probably can't fully explain at this point. But the Bible has given us some fundamental truth. One of the fundamental truths the Bible has given us is that there is one God. The Bible says, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one God. Now, some person says, well, when the Bible says one God, what does one God mean? You know, something as basic as that. What does one God mean? Well, it is believed that it's numerical one. Right? And let us look at that scripture. I think it's Deuteronomy chapter 6. Let us look at that scripture. So as I said, we know some things about God. You know, God has given us some information about him. One of the things that we know is that there is one God. And when the Bible says, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, he's here making reference to a numerical one. Not a one in terms of agreement in, you know, agreeing in one. But he's speaking about numerical one. And if we look at the next verse, it will become abundantly clear that the Bible is talking about a numerical one. Because here he says, because there is only one God, I can afford to love this one God with all my heart. Now, I don't have to divide up my love and say, I'm going to save some of my love for another God. I don't have to save some of my love for the Father. I don't have to save some of my love for the Son and then divide up my love in three. No, I can give all my love to God because there is one God. So from this, he's saying that, and notice again the word "and" there is linking it. And it is saying that, oh yeah, because there is one God, I can afford to love him with all my heart. I don't have to worry about loving any other God. I can give this one God all my love. So here we know that there is only one God. Now we see Jesus coming in the world and say, hey, you know, God is now manifested in the flesh. So the scripture said God manifested in the flesh. So right there I'm looking back and I'm saying, okay, is this another God? Or is this the same God that is now manifested in flesh, or made known in flesh. And so because I have the foundation that there is only one God, and when you look back at the scriptures, especially in Isaiah, you find a plethora of references stating that, "Hear, O Israel, you know, there is one God. Is there a God beside me? No, there is none. I know not any." And as I said, there are many, many scriptures that emphatically state that there is only one God. Now, if another entity come and say, "But wait, I am God also," then we're going to have a problem. We're going to have a problem. Unless we can show that it's the same entity. And this is what happened now. Jesus put on flesh and was incarnate. You know, but it is not a second person. It is just God manifested in the flesh. All right, so let us go back to the slides. Right, so as I said, we're looking at the nature of Christ. And so we establish that, you know, Jesus was God. He is God in the flesh. But not only is he God, he's also authentic man. The Bible refers to him as the man Christ Jesus in 1 Timothy 2 and verse 5. So Jesus is an authentic man. And if you look also in Luke 2 verse 52, you know, it speaks about his humanity, that he grew in wisdom and in stature and in favor with God and man. It's kind of a funny scripture to explain, but, you know, but we know the foundation that, you know, he was not only God, you know, but he was also fully man. Now we look at it and we say, as a man, he was tempted in all points as we were, yet without sin, the scripture said. Let us look at Hebrew 4 verse 15 state that you know, he was tempted in all points, you know, as we were, yet without sin. Luke 4 verse 1 to 11 give us the temptation of Jesus. And let us look at this one. Okay, so let us just read through it and then we'll explain it. And Jesus, being full of the Holy Ghost, returned from Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. Verse 2, being 40 days tempted of the devil, and in those days he did eat nothing, and when they were ended, he afterward hungered. And the devil said unto him, "If thou be the Son of God, command these stones that it be made bread." And Jesus answered him, saying, "It is written, that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word of God." And the devil, taking him up into a high mountain, showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. And the devil said unto him, "All this power will I give thee, and the glory of them, for that is delivered unto me, and to whomsoever I will, I give it. If thou therefore wilt worship me, all shall be thine." And Jesus answered and said unto him, "Get thee behind me, Satan, for it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him alone shalt thou serve." And he brought him to set him in a pinnacle. I think this is the third and last temptation. And he brought him to Jerusalem and set him on a pinnacle of the temple and said unto him, "If thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down from hence. For it is written, he shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee. And in thine hands they shall bear thee up, lest at any time thou dash thy foot against a stone." I think that is it. So there's a couple of things I like to just point out about the temptation of Christ. You know, the first thing is that, no, if you read, when you read the scripture, you'll find the devil is strategic in how he tempted Jesus. And I believe it's the same way he tempts us, right? The devil tempts us by trying to get us to go against a spiritual principle that is established by God and that is in the scripture. That's how the devil tempts us. Next slide, please. So the devil tempts us. Now, if you will notice, Jesus responds to all the temptation that the devil came at him with by stating explicitly, you know, and by highlighting the principle that the devil wants him to break. So this is how he answered. If you look at the three temptations, he answered, you know, he will quote the scripture that contains the spiritual principle that Jesus, that the devil wants him to break. So when we look at, so let us go in reverse order. So let us look at the last temptation here. The devil is trying to get him to worship him. Right? So he said, the devil said unto him, you know, cast thyself off. And, you know, he said that all of these things I have, and I will give them unto you, if you will thus bow down and worship me. Jesus quoted what I believe was Deuteronomy 6 and verse 13. That said, it is written, you know, thou shalt, he said, thou shalt what? Serve the Lord thy God, and him alone you should worship. Let us turn to that scripture. He said, thou shalt fear the Lord thy God and serve him. Right? So I believe this is the scripture that Jesus was quoting based on what is written here. And so here Jesus pointed to the scripture and said to Satan, Satan, I cannot worship you because the word of God say that I should only worship the Lord. And I should only serve him. Okay? Now, so there's a point also to be made about how we esteem the word. You know, because a lot of times when we are tempted, we fall to temptation, not because we don't necessarily know that the word said we shouldn't do that. You know, most of the time we know that the word said we shouldn't lie. We know that the word said we shouldn't steal. But the reason we fall is sometimes we don't have esteem for the word. We don't fear the word of God. You know, we don't fear God. And so, you know, even though we know, you know, sometimes we still end up doing it. But Jesus was saying here, I can't do this. I can't go against the word. You know, so he quoted the scripture and he said he can't do it. Now, let us look at the second one. The second temptation, he was asking him to tempt the Lord. Right? He said, throw thyself off of thy... he said that he took him up into a high place and said, throw thyself off, because it is written, you know, he shall give his angel charge over thee, and he shall bear thee up at any time thou dashest thy foot against a stone. That's what the devil said. Jesus responded by giving him Deuteronomy 6 and verse 16, I believe. So, yes, so the scripture here in Deuteronomy explicitly states, ye shall not tempt the Lord your God. So, in essence, don't put God to the test to see if he will do as the word of God said. Don't put him to the test. Don't put him on trial. The devil wanted Jesus, you know, to tempt, as it were, or to put, you know, God to the test. And the scripture clearly states that, you know, he shouldn't, you know, you shouldn't operate like that. And so for the first two, it's kind of clear. The Bible said you should worship the Lord thy God and you should serve him alone. And for the second one, you know, the scripture clearly say that you shouldn't tempt God. You shouldn't put God to the test. So Jesus said, I can't do that because I'll be going against the spiritual principle that says, you know, I shouldn't tempt God. But the first one is a little bit more harder to see the principle. But if we look again at the scripture that Jesus quote, it will give us insight as to, you know, what was happening here. So let us turn to Deuteronomy 6. I believe Jesus was quoting Deuteronomy 6 verse 16 here. And it says, man shall not live by bread alone. Deuteronomy 8 verse 3. Turn to that scripture. So this is what Deuteronomy 8 verse 3 said. And he humbled thee and suffered thee to hunger and fed thee with manna, which thou knewest not, neither did thy father knew, that he might make thee know that man doth not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of the Lord doth man live by. So this was a scripture that Jesus was quoting. Now, why was Jesus quoting this scripture? Why was Jesus quoting this scripture? Because the devil asked him to command that these stones be made bread. Now, as I said before, in all the other two accounts, he quoted the principle that the devil wanted him to go against. So I believe it's the same thing here. I believe that here Jesus was saying that this was the principle that the devil wanted me to break. And this is why he quoted the scripture and said, you know, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God. So evidently, you know, and I know the Bible said it was the end of his fast. And so, you know, the thinking is that, yes, it was really time for him to break his fast. But evidently, you know, this is the principle that the devil wanted him to go against. Now, if this is the principle that the devil wanted him to go against, then we would have to link it back to his fasting and he staying true to the fast and to the very end. You know, because that is the only way that he, you know, when we look at this, and if we agree that the scripture that he quotes were the scripture that the devil wanted him to go against, then the only thing we can garner from this is that the devil wanted him to break his fast before the time. You know, really, that's probably the only conclusion that we can draw here. And if he would have done that, then he would have been, you know, catering more to the physical man than to the spiritual, which would go against this principle that Jesus highlights here. Now, as I said, it's a little bit gray. There's a lot of little gray areas there, you know, but that is all I can come up with. You know, why would Jesus quote this scripture? You know, why would Jesus quote this scripture? Obviously, this was a principle that the devil wanted him to break, to go against this principle. And the only way he could go against this principle is if he probably would have broken his fast before the appointed time. Now, as I said, there's a lot of scholars that have different things out there, you know, but this is the one that I more, there are several school of thoughts out there, but this is the one that I more cling to, because it kind of makes sense. The only one that truly makes sense to me. But then, as I said, you know, you can also look at the other school of thoughts there. All right, let us go to the next scripture. So it is clear then to understand, though, that Jesus was tempted as a man. You know, he wasn't tempted as God. He was tempted as the man, Christ Jesus. All right? Next slide. So, it is interesting. So, there's a religion, I won't call the religion name, but there's a religion out there where there's some person said that, you know, this man is a god. They said he's God. Now, when they asked the man, and when they told the man, say, you know, people are saying you're God, the man denied it, and the man said, no, I'm not God. I won't call the religion name, but there was a religion out there. The man said, no, man, I'm just a king. I'm just a literal king of a nation, but I'm not a God. The man denied it, that he was a God. Now, did Jesus claim to be God? Because we are saying that Jesus is God, but did Jesus claim to be God? All right, let us look at this. Let us look at St. John 8, verse 56 to 59. So this is a exchange between Jesus and the Jews and the Pharisees, right? And Jesus said, our father Abraham rejoiced to see my day. He saw it and was glad. Then said the Jews unto him, thou art not yet 50 years old, and hast thou seen Abraham? Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am. Then they took up stones to cast at him. But Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple, going through the midst of them, and so passed by. So this is an account of, you know, Jesus making an emphatic claim that he is God. It's an emphatic claim on his part. Let us go back to the slide. You know, so the term he used here, I am, it might just look like a regular normal term, but it is not. It's not a normal term. And this is why the folks got so irate that they literally took up stone and said, look here, this man, we have to go stone him. Because what he said was unacceptable to them. They have to stone him, right? Why they were stoning him? Because they thought that he was saying that he was God. And how? Because he made this statement, I am. Now the first time we hear the term I am, it was used by none other than God himself in Exodus 3 and verse 14. And God said unto Moses, this is when God was asking Moses to redeem the children of Israel. And Moses said to God, God, I'm going to go to these people and I'm going to say to them, you know, God of thy father has sent me. Who art thou? Who should I say sent me? And God said to Moses, I am that I am. And he said, thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, I am has sent me unto you. So the I am is a phrase that is generally used with for God and God alone. No one else in the scripture ever claimed to be the I am. Right? No one else, you know, ever attribute the I am to anyone else. So for Jesus to come and say that he is the I am, it was an emphatic declaration to the world that Jesus was saying, I am God. That's what he was saying. When we look at the term, the meaning of the word I am, it's, you know, there are, again, there are several school of thought out there. There are those that says it is really the name of God, you know, but this writer here, and I'm quoting him, Ellicott, and this is what he wrote. He said, by nature, that is, cannot be declared in words. So when Jesus said, I am, when God said, I am, he's saying that my nature cannot be declared in words, cannot be conceived by human thought. I exist in such sort that my whole inscrutable nature is implied in my existence. I exist as nothing else does, necessarily eternal. If I am to give myself a name expressive of my nature, so far as language can be, let me be called I am. So basically, the writer is saying that, God is saying that, look here, there is really no words that can suitably describe who I am. You know, if I use a word to define myself, I would be basically restricting myself. You understand? No word in the English language can appropriately define who I am. You know, I have to just say I am that I am. You understand? So it's a powerful phrase. It's a powerful word. It's a big word. And for Jesus to come and say and use the same term to describe himself was an emphatic declaration that he was God. There was no greater way that he could say that he is God but to say that I am. You understand? And so for Jesus to say I am is an emphatic declaration to say to the people back then, look here, I am God. And they understood what he meant. They knew that he was declaring himself to be God. And they said, look here, we have got stone this man, because this man is saying that he is God. So they understood what he meant. And the Bible said Jesus just mystically, you know, just came out of their presence. But did Jesus claim he was God? Yes, he did. In St. John 8, verse 56 to 59, he explicitly stated that I am. And when he said I am, he was saying that I am God. In essence, based on the definition of the term. But let us continue looking at this. So this is another account. This is another exchange between Jesus and the Jews and the Pharisees. And let us look at this scripture actually in John 30 verse 34. So in St. John 10 and verse 30, it reads thus. Please talk back for me. Jesus made a statement. He said, I and my Father are one. I continue reading. Let me hear what happened. Then the Jews again took up stones. Then the Jews took up stone again to stone him. Right? Verse 32. Now, look at what Jesus said to them. Jesus answered them, many good works have I showed you from my Father. For which of these works do ye stone me? The Jews answered him, saying, for a good work we stone thee not, but for blasphemy, and because thou being a man, makest thyself God. Alright, so the Pharisees were saying that this statement that you made, Jesus, When you say that I am my Father is one, that statement is tantamount to you saying that you are God. That you being a man is making yourself God. Now some folks look at this and say, go back to this slide. Some folks look at this and say that, you know, Jesus was just saying that he and his Father agree in one. But that is not what Jesus was saying. Nobody wouldn't stone a man if he said that he and the Father agree. Nobody never stone anybody for that. The Jews, we have to mark the response of the Jews. The Jews knew that for Jesus to say that I and my Father are one is tantamount to him saying that he is God. And that's again, they took up stone to stone him and then tell him why. They said, you being a man is making yourself God. So that is, again, Jesus declaring to the crowd that he was God. But the thing I like about this scripture is not even that part. The thing I most like about this scripture is when Jesus asks them, he said, many good works have I showed you from the Father. For which of these are you going to stone me? You see that? He said, let us look back at that part. Because this is the part that interests me the most. He said, many good works have I showed you from my Father. Which of these works do you stone me? For which of these works? What was Jesus saying here? Jesus is saying that, look here guys, you are trying to stone me because I declare and that I claim that I was God. But I did it before. So why you didn't stone me then? That's what he was saying, you know. Jesus was saying that when I do these good works, when I heal the sick, when I raise the dead, this was an emphatic declaration that I was God. I was making the claim here that I was God. Why you never stoned me then? You should have tried. That's what he was saying, you know. Look at it. That's what he was saying. He was saying that you should have tried. Why you never? Which of these good works you gonna stone me? Since you are in the habit of stoning people who say that they are God, right? When I heal the sick, my works was testifying that I was God. You should have tried and stoned me then also. You understand? So that's what he was saying. Many good works have I done from the Father. For which of these good works are you going to stone me? These works was saying that I was God. When I healed blind Bartimaeus, I was saying to you, I was God. I am God. And just as how I am now declaring by my words that I was God, I was declaring by my action that I was God. So if you were going to stone me for saying that I was God, you should have stoned me also when my works declared that I was God. Right? But they didn't understand. And they said, well, for good work we stone you not. You know? But for you being a man is making yourself God. You know, but yes, Jesus declared that he was God, not just by his words, but even so by his works. Let us go back to the slide. Okay, the next slide, please. So this is what I said. Earlier, you know, next slide. So again, we are saying that the miracles that Jesus did was a testimony of his deity. Now, here's a question. If the miracle that Jesus did showed that he was God, How can you explain the miracle that the apostle did? Go back to the next slide, because I don't want anybody to see the answer. Because I want you to respond. Respond in the chat. I am saying, and the Bible is saying that, when Jesus did a miracle, right? When he healed the sick, when he raised Lazarus from the dead, that he was declaring that he was God. But the question that somebody is asking is that, okay, so why when the apostle do miracle, well, was the apostle declaring that they were God? That's a good question, right? Because if I made the claim that when Jesus healed the sick, it's because he was God while he healed the sick, then it should stand to reason. So I want somebody to explain that. I mean, put it in the chat. I'm not going to see it now, but I'm gonna go through and look for it later, because I want to see the response. I hope you understand the question. The question is, when Jesus did miracle, and we know that Jesus did many miracles, if those miracles was a testimony that he was God, and the scriptures seem to suggest that, then how do you explain when other folks did miracles? How do you explain that? All right, let us look at what I believe. So, let us go to Acts 3. To the gate beautiful. We're going to look at Acts 3, verse 12 and verse 16. So we're going to look at the first miracle that the apostle did. I hope you understand me and understand the question, and I hope you type your response, please. So this is the account at the gate beautiful. Now the Bible said, we know this story well, that Peter said, you know, the man approached Peter. If you could just go back a little, brother, so we can get the full, although we know the story, but to verse 4, maybe. And a certain man lame from his mother's womb was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms of them that entered into the temple. Who, seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, asked an alms. So the man asks for help. And Peter, fastening his eyes upon him with John, said, "Look on us." And he gave heed unto them, expecting to receive something of them. So, you know, it's interesting. It's as if he was building. It's like they were building his faith. Right? Verse 6. Then Peter said, "Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, I give thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." Let us look at verse 7 also. And he took him by the right hand. So Peter said, "Look here, you know, hold him by the right hand and lift him up." And immediately his feet and ankle bones received strength. Verse 8. And he leaping up, stood and walked, and entered with them into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. So this is the account of the first apostle miracle. I believe this is the first. This is the first one, right? First apostle miracle. Now, how did this man heal? So the question we're asking, you know, if we believe that Jesus, when Jesus did a miracle, he did a miracle, the miracle was a testimony that he was God, you know. Then how do we explain when the apostles did miracle? Well, if you go back to verse 6, we can see what this scripture said about it. So he said, Then Peter said, "Silver and gold have I none, but such that I have I give thee, in the name of Jesus Christ." So you see the difference? Peter is using the power that lies in Jesus to heal the sick. That is different from how Jesus did it. You understand? It's different. Let us look at verse 12, I believe. And when Peter saw it, he answered, let us go to verse 11 just for you to understand verse 12. Sometimes you don't understand unless you go to the scripture before. And as the lame man which was healed held Peter and John, all the people ran together unto them in the porch that is called Solomon, greatly wondering. So the people was amazed. And when Peter saw it, he answered unto the people, "Ye men of Israel, why marvel ye at this? Or why look ye so earnestly on us, as though by our own power or holiness we had made this man walk?" So Peter confessed, "Look here, it's not because of my own power or holiness." I continue. And he spoke about how God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob, the God of our father, has glorified his son Jesus, whom he delivered up and denied him in the presence of Pilate, which he was determined to let go. I think you should go to the next scripture, 16. And his name, through faith in his name, has made this man strong. So Peter was saying that it's because of faith in Jesus' name. You know, that is what caused the man to be healed. So again, Peter was just accessing the power that lies in the name of Jesus. Alright, so that is why there's a distinction here. But when Jesus healed the man, when Jesus did, as I said, when Jesus did the miracles, you know, he did it. Because he did it, and he doing those miracles was a testimony that he was God. All right, so let us move on. In the interest of time, we're going to move on. Yes, to the next slide. So another reason that we can say that Jesus is God is because he forgave sin, right? He forgave sin. That's another reason that we know that Jesus is God. Let us look at Mark 2 verse 4 to 12. Now, this is a very interesting story. That's Mark 2 verse 4. And when we're looking at the story when Jesus healed the paralytic man. And when they could not come nigh unto him for the press, they uncovered the roof where he was. And when they had broken it up, break up the roof, they let down the bed wherein the sick of palsy lay. Verse 25, when Jesus saw their faith, he said unto the sick of palsy, "Son, thy sins be forgiven thee." But there were certain of the scribes sitting there and reasoning in their hearts, "Why does this man thus speak blasphemy?" That same word again. So, who can forgive sin but God only? So they were right in a sense. They were right. They were right to say that it's only God can forgive sin. And immediately when Jesus perceived in his spirit that there is reason within themselves, he said unto them, why reason ye this thing in your hearts? The next verse. Whether it is easier to say to the sick of palsy, thy sins be forgiven thee, or to say, arise and take up thy bed and walk. But that he may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sin, he said to the sick of palsy, I say unto thee, arise and take up thy bed and go thy way into thine house. This is a beautiful story of a tremendous healing done by Jesus to a man that was suffering for years. Now let us just go back through. Let's go back through, and I think this is the final thing that we're going to look at. So let us go back through the first verse. So the Bible says that these men, when they could not come nigh unto him for the press, they uncovered the roof and they broke up the roof and they let the down the man, you know, that was sick of palsy, and they laid him before Jesus. Now the scripture says, when Jesus saw their faith. Now this is an interesting statement. When Jesus saw their faith. Are you able to see faith in an individual? You know, there's a scripture in the Bible where the Bible said that Paul was preaching. I believe the scripture said that Paul was preaching the word, and when he looked at a young man steadfastly, the Bible said that he saw in the young man eye, Bible didn't say eye, but he saw in the young man that he had the faith to be healed. Now, I don't know if that is how Jesus saw the faith of them, because he said, and when he saw their faith, so I don't know if it was a spiritual thing where he was able to see faith. I know sometimes when I look at people, I don't necessarily can see if they have faith or not. But Paul was able to I think the scripture is in Acts 14. Paul was able to look at a young man and say that he perceived that he had the faith to be healed. You know? But I'm not sure if this is the faith. So this is the scripture. Thank you for finding it. The same heard Paul speak, who steadfastly beholding him and perceived that he had the faith to be healed. So Paul steadfastly looked at the man and was able to perceive that the man had the faith to be healed. Now I don't know if it was a gift that Paul had. I don't know if it's insight by the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost revealed to him. Or was it by his experience, because he would have encountered many people. I'm not sure how Paul could determine that this man had the faith to be healed, right? However, here in this scripture, the Bible said, when Jesus saw their faith, right? The scripture said, when Jesus saw their faith, so that, and that's another thing, that's another point. Whose faith did Jesus see? The faith of the young men that was carrying in him. You know, but I don't want to go there yet. But the question is, can my faith cause you to be healed? Or do you have to have faith for yourself? Because Jesus said when he saw their faith, he was speaking, I believe primarily, and based on the context, he could be speaking of the young men that tear up the roof and let him down. And he was saying that when Jesus saw the faith of those young men. Now, it took faith to do that. It took faith to do that. And it comes back now to James, where James says, You know, faith without work is dead. It is hard to show somebody your faith without you doing some form of work. You understand? Unless you are Paul, we can see, say you have faith, or Jesus, you know? That's how I end up there in that scripture, you know, but it's hard. So James said that, James asked the question, how are you going to show your faith without your works? It is by your works. That is your works that tell me that you have faith. So it is obvious that these gentlemen have faith. It took faith. They knew that Jesus was going to heal the man. They felt it in their spirit. They knew he was able. They knew he was willing. And so they were willing to do whatever it took to get the man before Jesus. They said, look here. All we have to do is get the man before Jesus, and we know Jesus is going to heal him. So they break up the roof. Now, I'm not sure how expensive that roof was. And I'm not sure how long it would take them, because they probably would have to fix it back. Because it probably weren't their house. You know? But these men was willing to stop at nothing to get this lame man before Jesus. Now, the Bible says when Jesus saw their faith, could be that he could have seen it in their eyes the way Paul saw it in this young man's eyes. Or it could be that he looked at what they did, the work that they did, the fact that they were able, they went so far to tear up the roof and to let him down when he saw that faith. I'm not sure which one. You know, the Bible said He said to the man, thy sin be forgiven thee. Jesus looked at the man and addressed the greatest need that he had, which was the need for his sin to be forgiven him. Now, I believe the place was quiet, because this was not why these men had done all of this work. They didn't do all of that because they wanted to the man's sins to be forgiven, right? That's not why they did it. They didn't do it because they knew that the man was a sinner and that they want, you know, the man, Jesus, to heal the man's sin. But Jesus wanted to make the point that the greatest need that the man had was really the sin problem. And so he healed him first, knowing well that is not why they went through all of that. Jesus knew that they would not appreciate the man's sin being forgiven if he wasn't physically healed. He knew that, but he still did it. Because he wanted to make the point that the greater need was the sin need. And so the place probably was quiet. And the Pharisees said, boy, this man here, now look where him gone. Him gone forgive sin. Nobody can forgive sin except God. And they were right. It is against God we sin. And truly, only God can really forgive our transgression. David said it. When David took the man's wife, slept with her, caused the man to be killed, right? Caused the man to be killed. The Bible said that when David repented, David said, against thee, thee only have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight. So obviously it was against God. So yes, it is true. They were right. The Pharisees were right in a sense. It's only God can forgive sin. But what they didn't know is that the Spirit of God was in Christ. Alright? So he asked a question. He said, which is easier? He asked a question. Which is easier? Right? Let us look at that scripture. And again, I want us to participate. I really am used to feedback when I minister. So I find it very difficult to minister without feedback. But let us look at the scripture. Whether it is easier to say to the sick of palsy, thy sin be forgiven thee, or to say, arise, take up thy bed and walk. So which of these is easier, brother? Type it in the chat. Type it in the chat. Let me get your feedback. Which of them is easier? Please don't just count the words. Because he said, which is easier to say, right? Don't count the words. Don't just count the words. That's not. In fact, you can go to the slide. Yes, yeah, so which is easier? Just to say, thy sin be forgiven thee, or to say, take up thy bed and walk? Which is easier? Well, in order to answer this question, I gave it some thought as I prepared, and I said, why Jesus asked this question? And what is the answer? Is any of them easier? Is it equal? And I looked at it for a while and I said, well, which of them cost him the most? Which of them cost him the most? What did it cost Jesus to say unto the man, take up thy bed and walk? What did it cost Jesus to be able to say that? What did it cost Jesus to say to the man, thy sin be forgiven thee? Well, let us look at that. Alright, so for Jesus to say, take up thy bed and walk, according to Isaiah, it is by his stripes that we are healed. Right? So in essence, what am I saying here? For Jesus to say to this man, take up thy bed and walk. Right? He was able to say that because of the work that he did at Calvary. Right? But it wasn't the shedding of blood. It wasn't his life. But if we turn to Isaiah, and let us turn to that scripture in Isaiah 53 and the scripture that says, by thy stripes I am healed. Who has believed our report, and to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? Go down, I think it's verse 4 or 5. Verse 5. It says, but he was wounded for our transgression. He was bruised for our iniquity. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. So what did it cost Jesus to be able to provide, to be able to say to this man, take up thy bed and walk? To be able to heal the man physically, it cost him, it was his stripes, right? It's because he took 40 stripes, it believed. And the Bible said it is because of his stripes why we are healed. So it cost Jesus. So for Jesus to say to the man, take up thy bed and walk, it cost him 40 stripes. Now what did it cost him to say to the man, thy sin be forgiven thee? What did it cost him to say to the man, thy sin be forgiven thee? Well, the scripture said it. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. And so for Jesus to say to this man, thy sin be forgiven thee, in order for him to say that, he knew that, you know, he had to shed his blood. He had to die on the cross. When we say the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. We're not talking about, you know, getting a cut and bleed and blood was shed. No, we're talking about the actual taking of the life of something. So Jesus had to give his life to be able to say unto us, thy sins be forgiven thee. Because without the remission of, without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. So for me, if I was to take a shot at this, only Jesus probably truly knows the correct answer for this. But if I was to take a shot at it, I would say, to say to the man, thy sin be forgiven thee, is actually easier. Because it took less from Jesus. All it took, which was a lot, was the stripes, the 40 stripes that he bore. But for him to say to the man, thy sin be forgiven thee, cost him his life. And so that probably was harder. But that is, you know, that's what I put out there. I mean, as I said, I look forward to your view and to your interpretation of your opinion of what, which is easier. And let us move on. We're gonna close, but let's look at this last slide. The last thing we want to look at is, you know, was Jesus God? And we're saying, yes, Jesus was God. Why? Because Jesus accepted worship. Jesus accepted worship. So quickly now, we're not going to go to this scripture, but if we remember the case with Thomas, when Thomas said, look here, man, I know you guys are saying that he is risen, but I am not going to believe unless I see him for myself. And I have to push my hand in his side. And when Jesus showed up before Thomas on another occasion, you know, Thomas' response was this. He said, my Lord and my God. This was Thomas worshiping him. And Jesus accepted. Jesus didn't rebuke him and say, what you doing? He didn't do that. He accepted worship. And he's, you know, quickly in the interest of time. So not only did Jesus accept worship, but Jesus encouraged worship. He encouraged people to worship him. Look at Luke 19 verse 40. The Bible says that this is the incident when Jesus was going you know, his triumphant entry. In Luke 19 verse 40, the Bible says, the Pharisees said unto, but some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, right, teacher, rebuke thy disciples. Because the Pharisees recognized that they were worshiping Jesus. And they knew that worship only belonged to God. But what they did not know was that Jesus was God. So they were right, they were saying, you know, teacher, rebuke thy disciples. And what did Jesus respond? Jesus responded by saying, I tell you, if they remain silent, the very stone will cry out. So he was encouraging them to worship. And he was saying that, look here, if the rocks are going to worship me, if you man fail to do it. So not only did Jesus accept worship, Jesus encouraged folks to worship him. Now finally, in the book of Revelation, we see where not even angels in heaven accepted worship. Right? Not even angels. Look at this. The Bible says in Revelation, it says, and John, I, John, I'm the one who heard and saw these things. And when I heard and had seen them, I fell to worship at the feet of the angel who had been showing them to me. But what the angel did, but he said unto me, don't do that. I am a fellow servant with you and your fellow prophet and with all who keep the word of, and you really know what he's saying. But he went on and said, worship God. Right? So here we find the fact that Jesus accepted worship was an emphatic declaration that he was God. The fact that he healed, not just healed, the fact that he forgave sin, as we looked at earlier, was also a statement declaring that he was God. And then he actually said it. He said, I am that I am, also declaring himself to be God. So we're going to stop here. I think this is the last slide. We're going to stop here. Hope you would have get something from what was said here today. You know, in our next session, you know, we look some more at Jesus. I know we entitled the presentation "The Life of Christ." The Mind of Christ. But we're not going to be a slave to that. But we're going to just look at. But everything that we discuss is going to be about Christ. You know, I guess we can fear to say that. And so here we have a few announcements for you before we close in prayer. So remember, this weekend is Culture Weekend. And so from August 5th to the 7th, we're going to have event in the church. So on Friday is a talent night. So we want you to come out to that. I think it would have started a regular time between 6:30 and 7. It will get going at that time. And so come out to our talent night this Friday. Saturday, August 6th, starting at 11 a.m., we are going to be having another event, you know, that's not an all day, but it's from 11 until to later down in the day. And so there's going to be display booth, there's going to be a fashion from way back, looking forward to seeing some of the way back styles that are wearing back then. Of course, we're going to have food on sale, and these are going to be authentic Jamaican food. So, you know, come out with some funds so you can purchase. You know, all of this will go in aid of our building fund. We're going to have games and just a fun day. So we are encouraging you to come out and to spend the day with us on Saturday. And then, of course, Sunday, August 7th, we are going to have a special service with our culture events in mind. We are asking you to wear your Jamaican color. So I'm going to look here and see if I can find a green pants or something green so that I can come out in my Jamaican. Probably a shirt would be better, right? Yeah, I think you're right. Maybe a green shirt. Amen. So, you know, these are the announcements. So let us just close in prayer. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your goodness and your mercy. Dear God, we thank you for your words. Lord, we pray that we will be able to hide it in our hearts so that we may not sin against you. Have your own way as we give you all the glory. You alone is worthy of all the praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You are dismissed. Greet each other before you go.